I tell you what, we are in a truth emergency right now. When the commander-in-chief calls real crimes by his friends a hoax, while making up crimes by his opponents. When he spreads bogus fears about voter fraud. When experts look around and say, what voter fraud is he talking about? It means we are in a truth emergency. It's been happening a lot lately. People looking around saying, what is the president talking about? Where did he hear that? It's a truth emergency on top of a public health emergency. Experts like Dr. Anthony Fauci are being sidelined because the president cannot handle their truth. This week, when Trump said 99% of COVID cases are harmless, which is a harmful thing to say, Dr. Fauci was just like the rest of us. He said, I'm trying to figure out where the president got that number. When the president is confused, everyone else gets confused. So like I said, a truth emergency. Trump has taken up residence in an alternate political reality, former George W. Bush aide Michael Gerson says. Gerson blames in part the right-wing information bubble for this problem. In the bubble, editors get duped by Middle Eastern propaganda campaigns. In the bubble, some Trump fans buy into truly crazy claims about Satan-worshipping pedophiles infiltrating the government. Networks of conspiracy accounts spread this disinformation like it's poison. This is a truth emergency. When former members of the president's inner circle are blocked from writing books, when news outlets are tied up with baseless lawsuits, when even Fox News is not deferential enough to his wishes, when he even gets the ratings for NASCAR races wrong, we are all in a truth emergency. When presidential lies about the path of a hurricane prompt an internal investigation, when a single White House statement contains 12 lies and falsehoods, when the commander-in-chief repeats these lies so many times that they implant deep into the national psyche, we are in a truth emergency. Today he even lied about how much golf he plays, saying Obama played more than he did and for many, much longer periods of time. It's not true. It doesn't matter, but it's not true. In fact, it only matters because you're making it up. But some of the lies really, really matter. Trump's claiming, for example, that the virus death rate, that the coronavirus death rate in the U.S. is the lowest in the world, which is not true. At least 14 other countries have lower death rates than the U.S. So what do we do in this emergency? Well, first, to stay tethered to the truth, you should know, you should remember, most people are not buying this baloney. And while local news might be hurting, is hurting, many national papers are gaining subscribers, gaining revenue. There is a thirst for news and knowledge and truth. So we've got to keep making truth sandwiches. We've got to keep making sure that the facts are as accessible as possible. You know, it's remarkable how we see people storming the streets, you know, protesting lies, protesting injustice, speaking out about what they're seeing. These are all kind of antidotes to a truth emergency. So I'll tell you what's going to happen later today. We've just been talking about truth emergencies. Later today, some pro-Trump website is going to take this essay, and they're going to say, Brian, you are the truth emergency. And they're going to dredge up some screw-up by CNN. And they're going to say, what about that? This type of whataboutism, it's literally whataboutism, which has roots in Soviet Russia, goes on every day. It makes real discussion impossible. Of course, news outlets make mistakes. Of course, politicians make mistakes. The dividing line is between those who seek the truth and try to avoid mistakes and try to learn from them versus those who don't give a rat's arse about the truth and don't cop to mistakes and they just lie their way through life. In this truth emergency, we have to appreciate the difference between those who are trying to get it right and those who do not care. We have to defend the distinction between the two. 12 lies and falsehoods in a single Friday night statement defending the Roger Stone commutation? 12? This is not the behavior of a good faith actor who cares about the truth. And that statement came from the office of the White House press secretary, Kayleigh McEnany. As you know, she does hold regular briefings, unlike her predecessors. But those briefings are more like a game of beat the press. She comes prepared with scripted insults and put downs and whataboutism rhetoric. And that's why I want to tell you about this remarkable new op-ed in the Washington Post this weekend, titled, It's the Duty of the White House Press Secretary to Brief the Public, to Tell the Truth, but Not Like This. Let's bring in Jonathan Karl. He is, of course, ABC's chief White House correspondent and the president of the White House Correspondents Association. And finally, the author of the book, Front Row at the Trump Show. John, tell me about your op-ed for the Post. You've been in these briefings, front row for these briefings with Kayleigh McEnany, and they've been unlike any press briefing I've ever seen before.
Yeah, and I've been covering the White House on and off for a long time, Brian. I've been in that room under, I think it is now 14 different press secretaries, four different presidents. And I don't like to get into a personal back and forth with a press secretary. But what I have seen is I have seen those briefings turn into political shows, political events. I believe very firmly that the White House press secretary is a public servant, his or her salary paid for by the taxpayers, has a job to inform the public by informing the reporters that the public uses to get information. And, it's usually an intermediary role. Of course, the press secretary serves at the pleasure of the president, but this is a different job. She is not the spokesperson for a campaign. She is not the spokesperson for a political party. She is the spokesperson for the executive branch of the federal government of the United States. It is a different job. It is not a purely political job. And those briefings have begun to look purely political.
Yeah, you wrote in the op-ed on WashingtonPost.com that what she's doing up there is a violation of public trust. I think the counterargument that I often hear is, you all complained when there were no briefings, and now there are briefings, and you're complaining again. What's your reaction?
Well, yeah, I think that the press secretary has a responsibility to hold briefings, and that's why I argued forcefully throughout my time as president of the White House Correspondents Association for a return to regular briefings. I believe that the person who is the spokesperson for the executive branch of our government has a responsibility to go before the press and answer questions on a regular basis. But I also believe that those must be informative, that those can't be purely political. She has used those briefings over and over again to undermine the press, not inform the press. I mean, there was a briefing I'm sure you remember just a short while ago, where she looked out at the reporters in the room, I was in the room, and she said the people in this room desperately want to keep churches and houses of worship closed, as if reporters are somehow want to see churches
godless.
Closed. I mean, and she's gone out and she's cited crime statistics and murders in New York City, for example, and basically accused reporters in that room of not caring about people getting killed. It's strange. I hope that the op-ed will be a little bit of a wake-up call. I hope that she will change course. I mean, I am glad there are briefings, but I think that those briefings, shouldn't be purely political stunts.
Yeah, the briefings should be regular. Yeah, now they're regular, but they also should be reliable. They've got to be reliable.
Yeah.
She seems to come with these scripted lines. Paul Farhi of the Post said they're like these scripted walk-offs where she'll say something at the end that she was planning all along, which is, I guess, a show for Fox News, but not actually helpful for the reporters in the room that are trying to learn more about the president and policy decisions. What, as you're the president of the White House Correspondents Association up until Wednesday when Zeke Miller will be taking over for you. Everybody has a one-year term. Is there anything you're doing as the outgoing head of the association to lobby for improvements?
Well, I mean, the first thing was, and this I wrote this op-ed.
To write it, yeah.
It's my personal opinion. But that, I will advocate for this. And one thing I mentioned in the briefing is in the article is the notion of the press secretary as an intermediary. She serves at the pleasure of the president. But her job is to inform the public. And Mike McCurry, who was the first White House press secretary I ever covered, talks about how that intermediary role is really embedded in the geography of the West Wing of the White House. The White House press secretary's office is actually at almost exactly the midpoint between the Oval Office and the briefing room. And, usually the press secretary is arguing on behalf of the president, for sure, presenting the president's policies, but also arguing within the administration on behalf of the press corps. And I wrote this because this has to be an aberration. This cannot stay this way. I hope that Kayleigh will change course, but if not the next administration, you have to get back to a notion of that job being a public servant's job, not a political job.
It's such a simple concept, but it's been forgotten. I'm glad that you're calling it out. John, thank you. ABC's John Carl, author of Front Row at the Trump Show.